Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for inviting me to be here. I have to go now to the back draw a little bit, the bad things, radioactivity. Who thinks who is not radioactive in here? Everyone is radioactive? So, your health, that's very, very important. Because every one of us carries radioactivity in our body. And the world carries radioactivity as well. So we have to talk about radioactivity in anyhow. I want to give in my presentation a short overview of about our institute, because I guess you will not know what Karlsruhe Institute is. Then I have to give some terms, technical terms, activity and dose. Further on, I will go on natural occurring radioactive material and the difference of technical enhanced natural occurring radioactive material. I have to talk about decay chains, whatever it is, you maybe see it later on. And then I will go to regulations about it and the change of the process. Finally, I will give you some real world examples and give you also some information about regulation of radioactivity, natural occurring and technically enhanced radioactive material in building materials. KIT, as we short it, Karlsruhe Institute of Technology, has two missions. One, we are a university. And second, we are a large-scale research facility. Large scale means our projects running starting from 5 years to never ending. So that's the mission what we have in research. Just some numbers for you. We have roughly 9,000 employees. We have in total 22,500 students and almost 400 professors. Professors which are teaching on KIT. We have several professors on other universities as well. And the annual budget is not a small one, but we invest there. That's mostly half to the university side and half for researching. What is radioanalytical laboratories doing? We do analyze the activity of radionuclides by chemical separation or by direct measuring in a physical measurement department. So what we do is therefore we detect radioactivity in the environment, and we was primarily founded to protect the environment of our research center. Because some of the older people in the audience maybe know our old name, Karlsruhe Research Reactors. So we had some research reactors, and research reactors meaning we have to protect the site. So that was the time this lab was invested. So that's older than me, the lab, but I'm heading it now. And therefore we have to take care about health physics and environmental monitoring. If I went to look on the moment phase, at the moment we do 70% for on-site and 30% for off-site for industry, and many of the industry is naturally occurring radioactive material. That's not only rare earth, that's also glass industry and also other things where we have to deal with natural radioactivity in there. Just some numbers about our lab. In total, we are 19 people working there. We have a lot of samples running there. We just an industry lab almost, but still doing some research. We have several research projects running as well, besides the massive analysis what we do. So we have two opportunities in our lab. We know to do our job, and we can also do education and researching in both things. So that means we do not only research and researching samplings, we do also routine analysis, which helps a lot to understand and helps a lot the students to understand why they have to study this field. And that's a problem in our field, because as Germany decided already to shut down all nuclear power, we had already decided earlier phases to reduce the education in universities. And nowadays we have a lack of students for a radioactive field. So we have a lack of knowledge already. So we hopefully can engage Malaysia to get new students for this field, because to study about radioactivity is not a matter of nuclear power, it's a matter of our real world. And therefore we have a big lab for running this one. Just a little bit on numbers about the equipment what we have. That's a lot of equipment what we have in there, but I think you will go to lunch and want to know all of the details about our lab. And let's go to the real problem. How can we come from rare earth to radiation protection or radiation exposure? The present presentations was always about the chemical elements, the rare earth elements. They talked about mass percent and ppm. But I will have now to change the wording. What we are about to talk about is the object radioactivity, and what we measure there is the activity, and the activity is measured in becquerels. So we introduce new terms, and what is in the end is a radiation exposure. And I want to use the next few slides to explain you what is activity meaning, what is radiation exposure meaning, and what is the unit below their meaning, so that you a little bit better understand what I'm talking about. If I talk about activity, when we talk about activity, we talk about decays per time unit. Normally, decaying means that the core will, from an atom, will decay to another one and gives energy, and release energy. We measure it in decays, in numbers of changes per second. That's one becquerel. If you want to read it exactly, that's the legal term definition. But as one is already decayed, we have a change during the time, because the numbers are less, and then we had less of cost, so you can decay, so the decay changes, and the activity is changing during time. What I always talk now is numbers of atoms. I'm not talking about ppm. I'm talking about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 atoms. So activity can become very, very high, and you still have a very, very few amount of material. That's the term of activity, decaying of atoms. So just to give you a short impression about what this can mean, if you have uranium-238 and uranium-234, so you see the mass percentage is big, big difference, but the activity is the same. Because this is a mother, this is a daughter, and they have the same activity as well. And you see uranium-235, it's naturally occurring less, so you have a lesser activity. You see uranium is not dangerous. It's only for chemical reasons you have to wear gloves. You can take uranium directly in your hand from the radiation point of view. What's herein is just a short view of the decay chain. That's uranium-238, that's uranium-234, and we have in the one decay chain, it's the same activity level of, oops, I have to be careful for the background noise. Then you have the same activity in here. I will go on the decay chains a little bit deeper in detail the next slides then. What is the meaning of dose? If you're talking about dose, we meaning absorbed energy. Energy absorbed in our body from releasing of radioactivity. But there we have to decide between two different exposures. One is from external radiation and one is from internal radiation. So if we have an external radiation source, maybe here, then I have to go away and the source still stays there. But if I take the radioactivity in my body, I carry the radioactivity maybe my whole life with me, depends on the type of the element and how my body treats this element, so I can carry it around and then the radiation always exposes me from inside. So if we talk about activity, we have the amount. And if we talk about the dose, we calculate about the risk. The risk, what's happened if you take this amount in your body. So if you always want to think about safety things, you have to always think about the dose, and the unit is the sievert. Normally we talk about millisieverts. And millisieverts, you can equalize millisieverts to a risk that you maybe can get a health problem or a cancer. So let's go in German Radiation Protection Ordinance. German Radiation Protection Ordinance is the master regulation of radiation protection in Germany. And the German Radiation Protection Ordinance has since 2001 a special chapter which is dealing about natural occurring radioactivity, radioactive material, that's called NORM, and also technical enhanced radioactive material, T-NORM. And the part 3 is just dedicated for this part and has several pages. And the idea behind part 3 is to limitate the dose for the workers by 6 millisieverts per year and for the public to 1 millisievert per year. These numbers are very equal in Malaysian regulation, as I guess, very equal in other world around the same. So that's worldwide equals that we have to assume this. And this you can find, of course, this limitation of dose in a paragraph. And what is very important in Germany, it's reduction of dose. A reduction of dose to keep radiation exposure as low as possible. That means even if you fulfill the regulation, you have to think about if you can reduce it. So it's not enough to go to 1 millisievert. If you can easily, maybe by advanced chemical procedures to lower dose, then you have to adapt it. Then we have to talk about which fields can maybe cause increase of radiation exposure of workers and also other materials as well later on. Because if you have a license to work with radioactive material, then you know you have to fulfill the radiation protection ordinance. But who will know that he have a problem with radioactivity if you normally work with normal material? Most people don't. So the radiation protection ordinance sets up a list of fields of works where we maybe have a higher exposure for workers and maybe have higher exposure for the public. And the field of works are listed in appendix. I'll just show you this appendix later on. And you can read through and read through and read through. You find radon exposures, which is in underground mines. Okay, I can understand because there is a lot of good ventilation. So you have an inhalation of radon. Do you find rare earths? I can't find rare earths. So that means rare earth is not in the list of radiation exposures where workers could get a higher radiation exposure risk than 6 millisieverts per year. So the German Radiation Protection Ordinance says no risk for the workers. Let's look on the rest. If you look on the radiation protection for public cases of naturally occurring radioactive material, and residues require surveillance and in permission shipment, so we also not allow to ship our residues back to somewhere else. We keep it in our country. That's a policy in Germany totally. And then we have also this stated in appendix. And if you look in this appendix, you won't find rare earths. So rare earths residues maybe have a problem to increase the dose of the public. And that means it needs a control of the residues regarding to the German radiation protection ordinance. So what we have to control are the residues. And therefore we have to look on residues. But before we have a look on residues, we have to look on which radionuclide we have to look. I got a title for my invitation, I have to talk about uranium and thorium. But if you look on a decay chain, this chain is very, very, very long. There are several elements listed here. And you see some of them have short half-lives, but if the mother is long-lived, it is produced. So if you talk about radiation protection, we have to look on the elements, on the radionuclides who deliver the dose. And therefore, we have to look on the whole bunch of nuclides listed in here. So that's our mission, what we have to do. And before we can do this, we have to look on what's happened, chemical or geochemical. The first speaker already talked about changing things in the geological needs millions of years. Yes, but there are still some changes. And we can divide the groups in so-called geochemical relevant groups. Thorium has their own chemistry. So thorium is outstanding. Then you have the radium, actinium part, because radium is very easily soluble by water and can be extracted also in geochemical phases. And then we have the rest, thorium-228, and the rest down to lead in one group. So there was a thorium phase. So thorium phase, we have only two subgroups mainly, that's thoriums, and we have the radium phase from geochemical point of view. If you look uranium chain, that's a little bit complicated because there is a thorium-productinium overgun. Then we have a long, long half-life in here. Then we have, once again, radium. Then we have this lead-210, which has a very long half-life. And last, we have a stable one. So it says separate sub-chains, but we have to look on which corresponding to each other. If you look on changing ratios during chemical processes, and as a speaker just before me already talked about chemical processes, they know a lot what chemical processes are doing. And chemical processes changing, of course, the radioactivity concentration. We cannot see that every nuclide which is in this chain will be in the chain after chemical separation. So that is very important, starting with radium. Radium is water soluble. So it means you can extract it very simple, and it's not in your chain. So if you detect radium, it must not be that everything else will be there. Maybe only radium can be there. So next one is radon. Radon is a noble gas. Noble gases will gone away during a process. So you maybe lost your noble gas, and then you lost probably in some nucleus following up. And the next one in this chain, just for example, is polonium-210. Polonium-210 can sublime by a temperature about 80 degrees Celsius. So if you have a very heat processing facility with higher temperatures, you maybe extract your polonium, and then you get a changing in the decay chain as well. So it means the control of the residues have to take into account that you have to understand proper the chemical behavior of the elements in your decay chain. Otherwise, you will detect the wrong element or the wrong radionuclide, and then you've gone lost during the change in the residues. But what is the aim of the control, what we have to fulfill? The easiest way, and I said this was the industry we're going through, is to go below 0.2 becquerel through gram. Because the German Radiation Protection Ordinance says if you are below 0.2 becquerel per gram for each nuclide in the decay chains, then you have a normal material which is natural. So it means it's not a residue, it's not a radioactive waste, it's just free for spend. You can do what you want to do with everything else in our world. How can we detect it? Analysis is done normally with gamma ray spectrometry. The method how to deal with residues is described in an ISO standard. It is very simple. It is done with almost no sample preparation, so the control can be done directly by take a sample and measure it. The measurement is almost automated. And if you have at least 30 days old samples, you have a very, very good chance to detect all these nuclides from both decay chains going down to 0.2 becquerel per gram. And only polonium-210 is the only one which we maybe need an extra measurement, because polonium-210 is not very quite detectable by gamma ray spectrometry. Gamma ray spectrometry, just a short overview. You take a sample, put it in a container, put it on your detector. It's almost no preparation. You get a spectra, you get a calibration curve, and finally you get a result. So it's a very simple method. That means you can control residues very easily by just take a sample and measure it. But you have to do it. So that's saying what I have to point out. Don't forget to make a control. But the control itself is not a big deal. Which nuclides are detectable by gamma ray spectrometry? These are the two major chains what we have to look on. And you see in this chain, all these green rings we can detect. And if you look between, we have very, very short half-lives. So that means if we detect these ones, we have almost done everything. And in the other decay chain, it's versus wise the same. We have almost each radionuclide in the chain we can detect by gamma ray spectrometry. So the control is very easily to be done, and you can control it very simple. What you need is a software tool to be ensure that you have really a stable decay chain, because that is the problem what we as analysts do not know. I'm not a chemistress, and I do not know how to separate rare earths, so I do not know what's happened with my elements in my decay chain. But I do an analysis, I have to be proven that if everything is equilibrium, it means that the decay chain has the same level, which is done by a software which we developed during a master thesis. During a master thesis, and he developed a software where you can see the activity of the sample for the different nuclides and the error bars, and you see that's almost the decay chain which is stable, so there's no change in this chain, and you are sure that you do a proper measurement with a gamma ray spectrometry. Some real world examples. I hope I have the time. These are samples what we analyzed in our lab, and coming from very close to rare earth industry. And you see here, radium, almost nothing. Lead to 14 and bismuth to 14, almost nothing, but a lot of lead to 10. So the decay chain can be changed. And that is needed, that you have to control each radionuclide, which was already stated in the Radiation Protection Ordinance. Each nuclide in the decay chain must be below. And you have to therefore look on each nuclide, as you easily can see. Here is the sample where we have a lot of lead-210, but nothing else. The other extreme, this one, is lead-210 and polonium-210. Lead-210 is a metal, polonium-210 is a daughter. Half-life of the daughter is only 140 days. So for geochemical reasons, there can't be any change. But for chemical reasons, there can be a change just by high temperatures. And you see we have much more polonium to tennis samples than we had lead to tennis. So sometimes it's very important to look very detailed on the process. And as long as you understand the process proper and you know what your elements do, then you can see what your radionuclides do, and then you can have to assess your measurement things. But now we have activity. How do we come to dose? Regulated is the dose. How we get exposed by residues which come from a rare earth facility? The exposure pathways are illustrated here. What we have to assume, probably we get a pollution in the water. Probably we're standing here and get radiation from somewhere. Probably there are food growing up here, German food. Sorry, saffron, in most cases, not Malaysian food. Or we have some radioactivity as gases or dust in our environment. So that means what we have to do, if we are above 0.2 becquerel, we have to ensure that the dose for the public is below 1 millisievert per year. And this is very, very complicated. Because you have really to assume what can happen with the nuclide if a deposit is there. And that's a research field. Because there you have to invest all the information what you normally not have directly. And in Germany we have a standard regulation which is already given us versus is regulated for all the pathways. And the sum of the dose for all pathways must be below 1 millisievert by conservative perspectives. And I can say to you, if you will eat all this food which is in the regulation given in Germany, you will be very fat. Because it's a mission impossible to eat so much food for a person. But I do not know if he is more food from more fish or is he more beef? So I assume he is a maximum beef eater, he's a maximum fish eater, we took both together. And so we do all the things to get a secure site. So that means the dose estimation, what we can do at the end, is the maximum dose, it's very conservative, and that means no one will ever reach this dose limit. Only some percent of this dose, probably. Just go back to norm and T-norm in building materials. That's not a rare earth thing. The radioactivity is out there. In our earth, it's nature. And radioactivity can come to your building materials. And therefore, I was very wondering about the Chinese people. That was the first time I was coming in contact with this building material. There was a German factory of tiles. They want to sell tiles to China. And they have to fulfill a Chinese standard, which is given down there, for radioactivity in tiles. The reason is very simple. Because if you use the tiles in your house, you live on in the tiles and you get dose exposure. So that means naturally occurring radioactive material is always there, and we have to take care about it, no matter if you have a rare earth facility or the normal things. So that means you need a regulation. And in European, we have European guidance. European guidance means that's a scientific agreement. Is it not meaning you have to do it? It depends on country to country what they want to do. Italian take care about this guidance totally. German don't take care about it. They say we have no problems with building materials. But maybe in future we get a regulation on that, which is then kept in an ordinance. And it's very simple. If you just look on the concentration of radium, the concentration of thorium, and the concentration of potassium in building materials, divide them, add them, and then you can separate in three different levels and say, okay, if this material is used in bulk amounts, concrete, for example, then you have to go on very, very low levels. Otherwise, you get a high radiation exposure. And if you use it just in restricted materials, you can go maybe on higher levels. And then there are two dose levels given. I would assume you should go on this level for building materials because we can reach this very easily. But it's the same strategy is given here also in this Chinese standard. And it's very, very similar and very simple. And if I can give you a tip, don't copy the German regulation, copy the Chinese one. It's shorter and has the same content. because the regulations in Germany are always very, very, very complex. But the sense is the same. So let me give the summary. Radiation risk from rare earths is controllable. We can control it. The German radiation protection body don't see any risk for the workers. Residues of rare earths need a control. And the disequilibrium of the decay chains needs to be understood for chemical processes in the industry. And the control of residues can easily be done, and methods therefore are published. And if the control is done properly, the risk could be very low for the public. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Chris.